best, I guess, to do a longer, or to start doing some longer readings, because I know my videos are relatively short compared to a lot of ASMR stuff. I'm so small, I'm such a small channel, that the idea of actually comparing myself to other ASMR channels is kind of strange. But anyways, I figured I would try to do a little bit of a longer one here. And I have actually just recently come into possession of a virtually complete Bretonnian army, including the most recent, unfortunately, 6th edition Bretonnian army book. So, I figured I would give you guys the history of Bretonnia and the history of Gilles the Uniter. And, just a fair warning, there's a lot of French names in here, and it has been a while since I have worked on my French pronunciation, so I'm not even going to bother. We're just gonna go straight American California English for this. The history of Bretonnia, being an account of the rise of the Bretonni and our lord Gilles the Breton, as scribed by myself, Adelrond of Caron, the battles of Gilles the Uniter and the companions. Loyal subject of the king, be it known to you that in the bygone age before the lady was found, the green-skinned beast did wreak havoc and rampage across Bretonnia. In that time of dole and sorrow, many proud tribes of this fair sacred land were hewn and slaughtered as cattle. Score upon score of greenskin armies did ravage and rage like the thunderstorm deep into the verdant heart of the land. In the north, virtue fared little better. Barbarians once more beset great river and coast for to burn, rapine, and pillage. The hated, twisted beasts of dark forests harried forth from their darkened groves, and great pyres of Bretonni flesh turned day to night with black char smoke. Death, too, did ride unfettered throughout once fair lands. Those that would do his foul works unchecked, and possessed of great rage. So basically, we're starting out with Bretonnia being completely fucked. All did seem lost for the Bretonni, and the land itself did weep and wail in heart grief as all life was choked away. Greatly sought upon was the safety of the castle strongholds, and the sword swains of our fair nation did stand aghast as their lands were consumed. But lo, in fair Bastogne, the young Lord Gilles did refuse to concede his land to the dark. Upon a mighty charger he rode out against the foe, those faithful to his sword and to the lands upon his heel. Many of his proud knights did fall and join the land, but afore the tip of Gilles' lance, the canker-devouring Bastogne was cleansed. Visions spake unto Gilles of the multitude of enemies that stood poised to destroy the land of his peers, and 3 days hence Gilles did avow to ride forth with his surviving knights. For should the mighty war hosts of the green-skinned beast flow into one great tide, the lands of the Bretonni would come unto their doom. And be it known that fate did smile upon Gilles, for at his side rode longtime friend and blood brother Thierulf of Lyonesse, and famed Landuin, lord of Mousselon, and finest knight that ever was. The twilight sky bore witness kindness to them as they made their peace in the shade of the forest of Chalon, prepared to give their lives as one in the next day's battle. But lo, on the morn, a ghostly vision came unto them, a maiden of surpassing beauty and fey power, arising from the mirror sheen beside which they were camped. The knights knew full well that the sublime apparition was no mortal creature, for nary a ripple disturbed the waters. She gifted her bounty and her blessing unto Giles, enchanting his banner with her likeness. The bodies of the companions became suffused with unearthly strength and light. Their eyes did glow with lambent flame from within, and their weapons and armor shone with new power. Thus did Giles, Landwin, and Thyrulf transcend the mortal clay and earn sanctity to become the very first of the Grail Knights, the famed companions of the Grail. On the morn, the enemy, arrayed upon the field, were like unto a living sea, of such number that all hoped seemed forlorn. Yet Giles and his companions rode forth as vengeful gods of war and parted the tide. Victory after victory was won, 100 score fell before their terrible wrath. The verdant fields ran crimson and black, and the green skins, trapped twixt sword and sea, fled howling into the tide to be claimed by the cold claw of Mainan. Few escaped the fury of the blessed knights, and the lands were saved. Giles unfurled the standard of the lady upon a great mound of the dead, and the people did rejoice. In this deed, Giles had won the first of his famed 12 great battles, and with it the allegiance of Lord Marcus of Bordeleau and Lord Fredemund of Aquitaine. That day, the first forged bonds of brotherhood that were to unite the Bretonni were the true prize. And Giles' victory was a beacon of hope in the bleak and dire night, and his companions were an inspiration to soldier and seneschal alike. But whither should they wend, asked Landwin, and Giles did reply, south. The knights took the coast, the seas calming at their passage as they rode through the surf towards embattled Brionne. They came upon the rear guard of a great war horde of greenskins, their lords borne aloft on long-necked wyverns. Upon their sight, Fredemund did sound his clarion horn and summoned to him a mighty flock of falcons that struck terror into the black hearts of the enemy and tore at the wings of the orc beasts, driving them to the ground. The knights fought deep into the heart of the greenskin horde, where Landwin struck down the bloated orc warlord, and Fredemund slew his monstrous mount. Thus was the second great battle won. And so from that day, riding hard, companions five did travel onward to the besieged castle Brionne. Just as they struck the foe garnered about the great moat, Lord Baldwin of Brionne sallied forth across his oaken drawbridge with the last of his knights. Baldwin himself took the brutal axe that day, stuck fast in his shield, and emblazoned there forevermore. Though their number was outmatched 15 score to 1, the Bretonni tore through the greenskins like a scythe through wheat in harvest, and Giles and Baldwin did hail well met in the midst of battle. They clasped forearms as brothers, and Baldwin was joined into the number of the companions. Thus was the third great battle won. Afterward, urged ever on by night blessings and visions from the Lady of the Lake, the companions did venture to cross the mighty river Brienne and spurred their chargers 100 league through the shattered lowlands of Carcassonne toward the land of Quenelle. Lambert of Carcassonne did spy the banner of the lady and come unto their side, and as they raced through the day and night, the companions clashed swords with greenskin borne upon did snap hungrily at their steeds. The companions held true, and after several weary nights, the shadow of great Quinnell did fall upon them, but rejoice was denied. They were greatly vexed to sight the borders of fair Lorraine aflame. Though each were bone-weary and in sore need of succor, the divine power of the lady flowed strong, and the companions made haste unto the greenskins that did hew and put to flame the ancient forests. A night of blood and fire came upon them, and the companions fought tirelessly with skill unmatched and awesome majesty. The dark was lit by shining sword and eye ablaze, and the wrath of the goddess was such that her champions could not fall. Bow joined blade as the ancient forest came to the companions' aid, to choke and bind, to smite flesh and break bone. The fae spirits of that haunted forest did flit and glimmer beyond sight amongst the branches, striking down those that dared do harm to their realm. Thus did Giles become friend to the fae, and did win his fourth great battle. Granted restful sleep by the lady, the companions greeted the new sun to find themselves refreshed, and their wounded bodies whole and sound once more. Suffused with the vigor of a spring dawn, the companions did ride northward to lend their swords to beleaguered Paravon. Now amongst their number, Radamund the Pure, Lord of Quinnell. And so it came that the eight companions did ride upon once handsome Paravon, carved from stark mountainside by the river Grismarie, only to find, after 7 nights of long travel, that it stood in wrack and in ruin. Fell giants aloft in the peaks above did heft and rain borders down upon the city below. Borne aloft on his faithful Pegasus Glorfinial, Lord Agilgar of Paravon wheeled through the air above the city, the better to take the battle to lofty crag and distant airy, and did smite the foe. The Goblin of the Severed Hand, that's G-O-B-L-Y-N, just in case it wasn't fancy enough, did defile the streets and citizens below, setting a great flame and taking fair maidens into slavehood. Through cobbled streets charged the companions, cleansing alley and courtyard, riding down enemy without number beneath iron-shod hoof and casting twisted, lumpen bodies on into the flames. Thus was the fifth great battle won. And that day, Agilgar did gladly troth his lance to Giles, and the blossoming coterie of companions galloped on, until as the sun set, they came upon the land of Montfort. There they saw the towering Lord Mertred and his kin give their all to fend clear a dozen tribes of fierce night goblins, who gushed forth from the mountainside in a number like unto a black and unstoppable flood. Axbite Pass, that dark vale upon which Castle Montfort broods, was carpeted in a carrion feast of 1,000 dead. The companions rode out into the black-clad fiends and did lay about themselves mightily until, alas and woe, how great the pity. Giles was transfixed upon a mighty bolt, sent heartward by an infernal device of the cowardly goblin. Weeping, the companions bore their lord in fever dream aloft into the castle. A night of dark grief and desperation came, the companions as unquiet ghosts around Giles' death pallet, as leeches and surgeons were heard to dolefully proclaim that dark night to be his last. It is unmeet that I should write of the depths of the companions' woe. was within Giles. And as dawn broke, the fallen hero did grasp the shaft of the bolt with a great roar, and pull it bodily from his chest, where light streamed out. Grim and wrathful, Giles was like unto a divine sky warrior as he rode forth once more, smiting a three flock of wyverns that descended upon him from the black-bellied skies, one felled by the very bolt that had struck him. A full week was embattled Montfort besieged before the companions turned the tide. The night goblins fell away into their dank caverns and dark chasms to lick at their wounds as dogs in their misery. Thus was the sixth great battle won. But be it known that Giles would not let the enemy from under his sight, and did lead his companions after the retreating foe, plunging into the everlasting night of the caves. On and down and on and down they galloped ever deeper through the labyrinth, their only radiance the flame that licked from blade and blazed in eye. They slew all the trolls and the dark creatures of the depths that came upon them for to bar their way, delving ever downward into the dark heart of the mountain where man was not meant to tread. And they knew no fear. Within those dark and fetid halls, the goblin kings were cut down from throne and skewered upon lance like unto hogs. Thus was the seventh great battle won, and Giles fought a path back toward the light, drenched in the black blood of the foe. 10 strong, the Bretonni lords, bolstered by Martred of Montfort, then rode north and westward toward Guisereau. Here they were joined by Baron, master of that troubled land. Once more did they come against foul and frothing greenskins in this, their next great battle, but this time the evil beasts had called down the eyes of their base gods. These twin and savage spirits sought to smite the companions, but the heavens did shake with their frustration, for, as all know, dark magics cannot harm those under the auspice of the Lady. There began a fray, fell and fierce. Lord Baldwin rode before the companions in a fury unto a berserk of the north, hewing the heads off a dozen shamans with a single sweep of his axe. Tens of thousands numbered the slain that day, yet not a drop of blood fell from the companions in their stride. The green-skinned beast fled in disarray from their The green-skinned beasts fled in disarray, for as their conjurations failed, their hope was extinguished. Holy shit, I'm having a hard time. Okay, take three. The green-skinned beasts fled in disarray, for as their conjurations failed, their hope was extinguished as a candle in a storm. Thus was the eighth great battle won. On the morn, the companions made haste to the west. They entered upon the lands of Mousselon, pride of the realm of Landwin. Alas, hope proved false for poor Landwin, for in his absence his land had been turned to smoldering ruin. Cattle lay slaughtered in blackened wasteland, and once pure river was dark with foulness. A bilious stench carried up from swampland, where in times past virgin glade stood proud. The companions rode in grim silence through the gates of Mousselon, for to join with the remains of Landwin's family and Fulgar, the neighboring lord of Artois. Fulgar had come with dire news of a great host marching. Fulgar had come with used, marching under full moon. Upon all sides, beset by beast and living dead, the companions fought as Chatelaine. I don't know what that means. One to each wall, there to hold out alone against the foe. Giles hewed the head from an immense drake beast's shoulders. Thirulf wrestled with a monstrous two-headed giant, while Agilgar, borne aloft upon his Pegasus, joined battle with bat-winged fiends in the lightning-laced clouds above. The companions found triumph when Landwin struck down the foul night creature that had called the dead forth from their peace, and the beast kin fled howling into the darkness of the forest. Thus was the ninth great battle won. That sounds like a coalition between the undead and the beastmen, and that sounds weird. Having triumphed, the companions spurred their warhorses to the north. Thereafter, many long nights in the shade of the forest of Arden, they did come upon the elf-laid stone of Languil, city fortress of the coast, and they hoped to find a respite. But to no avail, as the grand port was embattled by crude men of the north, clad in pelt of fur and steel. And the companions did meet them in a great tempestuous battle, joining the lord of the city, Lord Corduin. As the battle raged night upon night, day upon day, the moons turned, and many thousand savages and barbarians were hewn and cast wailing into the sea. But the fierce foe paid no regard. Orgoleous and grim, the Northmen would not give, for they sought glory or death in the eye of their bloody gods. In desperation, Lord Marcus of Bordeleau did throw down his challenge to the fell Lord of the Norse, the towering giant Svengar of the Scalings, find victory or take leave. In his pride, Svengar would not refuse. Many brave warriors had met death under the barbarian's bloody hand. Yet fear did not chill Marcus's heart, for he knew that the lady was with him. Then did the warriors meet atop the towering lighthouse of Languil, ancient and fey in construct, all Bretonnia at their feet. Cloud roiled and storm lashed as the combatants fought, the elements themselves conspiring to aid the twin hammers of Svengar. Night bowed to day, and day to night, and still the warriors fought, a concert of steel reaching the ears of all below. Finally, Marcus opened his foe's guard, and struck his opponent with a blow of such might he fell in twain to the rocks below. In respect of the warrior skills of the Bretonnian lords, the Norse took sail back to their icy homelands. Thus was the tenth great battle won. I'd be willing to bet they probably ran because their general had died, and it probably wasn't worth getting their asses kicked anymore. The companions rested well that night. On the morn, they pressed toward the rising sun, unto the province of Coron, where they were joined by Lord Carleond. There they faced the amassing armies of orc kind pushing towards Languil. On the banks of the fast-flowing river Sanez, battle was met, and the water did run black that day with foul blood spilled. The orcs turned their eyes from the great halo of light playing round the companions, and were struck down into the mire as they turned to flee. Never before had such a great toll of greenskins been slain upon a single day, nor ever since. So much tainted blood. blood quenched the dry earth that it seems as marshland underfoot even to this very day. Thus was the 11th great battle won. Now, lend your ear to the 12th great battle of Giles, fought upon the great and verdant fields of Curon Plain. To southwest over the river did squat the dark and haunting forest of Ardennes. From within depths uncharted came loping all manner of monster and great beast. Giants, trolls, and creatures without name came stalking through a press of beastmen so great that from a vantage they seemed to the companions as swarming insects crossing the ford of Senez. Tribe upon tribe of greenskins descended from the Pale Sisters to the southeast and blackened the horizon with a horde of 5,000 score at least. There was so great a noise and tumult that it seemed as if the earth would shake and split asunder. The companions made their prayers and arrayed themselves for this final battle, but disaster played its hand once more as, at their back, the fair city of Curon was overrun by an unnatural tide of vermin. Rats, walking as men, took notched blade to the guard and erupted in great number from the gates to threaten the companions from the rear. Surrounded on all sides by a number of foe beyond countenance, the companions yet stood resolute and without fear, for the lords of each of the 14 lands of the Bretonni now stood as one, the gathering complete, and their brotherhood and bonds of faith stood stronger than steel. They knew in their hearts of the lady's power flowing through them that day, and that none could stand against them. Mighty indeed was this last and most epic of battles, and each companion performed such deeds as to fill the sagas of wordsmiths and scribes until the end of time. The moons raced across the darkened sky, replaced by the burning orb of the sun, but to no respite. Only the lady knows the number of weeks that saw battle, but against all odds, the companions emerged victorious. The piles of dead were stacked like unto mountains, and searing pyres burnt the slain enemies such that night was turned to day for a season and more. Thus was the 12th and final great battle won. It was in this way were the sacred lands of the Bretonni scoured of evil and its peoples made safe. The death of Gilles le Breton. Alas, years later, death did take his due. Gilles, honored as the Breton and the Uniter, was calamitously struck down. A veritable god of war that had by his great deeds won peace, some whispered he had no place. Whoa, hold on. A veritable god of war that had by his great deeds won peace. Some whispered he had no place. He sought out battle wherever it lay. I'm not quite sure who wrote that sentence. He was slain by a fell weapon loosed by unknown hand, and to this day the knights of Bretonnia forswear the coward's weapon that kills from afar. With his dying breath, he bade to be buried unto the nearby lake before his journey to sainthood became complete. There his body was laid reverently upon a ghostly ship that seemed formed from the mists. With lamentations and much mourning, each companion watched through tear-streaked eye as Giles transcended from this earthly coil to an isle of bliss in the other world, there to join the lady herself for all eternity. And yet he is not gone to us, for it is said by prophetess and seer that in our darkest hour, Gilles the Breton, great uniter and slayer of armies, will come unto us once more from that fey isle. Thus ends the majestic history of Gilles le Breton. And yet, as far as I know, he didn't. Bretonnia was fairly lacking when the end times finally arrived, probably because Games Workshop doesn't care. Didn't care. And still doesn't care about Bretonnia, despite the fact that even though they are one of the least inspired, perhaps, armies, you know, it's very derivative, it's clearly, you know, Dark Ages, French Catholics, but I think they are one of the most flavorful armies. They just, everything about them is so, they're a beacon of purity in an otherwise very dark world. Even the high elves have this history with chaos that makes them, despite their, you know, white armor and tall towers and gems and all this stuff, it makes them sort of tragic. Sorry, you can hear my roommates outside my door. The high elves are sort of tragic, where Bretonnia is pure. And I love that. I think that is so cool. So that was the history of the foundation of Bretonnia. There's still a lot of lore stuff, just like with the High Elf book. There's all the stuff about the different wars they fought and whatever, the rise of King Lewin. But I think I'm going to save that for another video. Anyways, I hope you guys liked this. And I hope you look forward to more Bretonnia stuff, because I certainly do. I played my first game with this army against my girlfriend's High Elf army, and oh boy, did they get their asses whooped in about a turn and a half. But I still think this is a spectacular army. Yeah, sorry, I'm rambling. Until next time.